Plantar Fasciitis by Emily Marshall and Casey Sinders. Here's a list of our objectives, which will serve as a roadmap as we describe the examination and management of a common foot problem, plantar fasciitis. The plantar fascia is a thick fibrous aponeurosis that originates at the medial calcaneal tubercle and helps to support the arch of the foot. Plantar fasciitis is characterized by a thickening and degenerative change of this aponeurosis, which may or may not have an inflammatory component. Recent studies have suggested that there is a lack of inflammatory mediators in the tissue involved in individuals with plantar fasciitis. A more accurate term is plantar fasciosis, or more simply, chronic heel pain. Prevalence. It affects approximately 2 million Americans each year. It is the most common foot condition treated by health care providers. Prevalence ranges from 5.2% to 17.5% in a systematic review of running-related musculoskeletal injuries. Overall, heel pain is a prevalent foot issue among both athletic and non-athletic populations. Diagnosis. There is no gold standard for diagnosis of plantar fasciitis. It is a clinical diagnosis via palpation of the calcaneal tubercle. Imaging is not common, however, plantar fascia thickness can be measured via diagnostic ultrasound, and it will be thicker in affected individuals. Radiograph can be used to rule out other causes of heel pain, such as fracture or a bone spur. Just as with any musculoskeletal condition, a thorough history can give valuable information when a patient arrives in your clinic with plantar heel pain. Among those factors are pain over the medial calcaneus, pain after a period of inactivity, pain that initially decreases with activity, but then increases with prolonged weight bearing, heel pain caused by a recent increase in weight bearing activity, and the absence of numbness, tingling, burning, or other neurogenic symptoms. There are factors that can predispose one to developing plantar fasciitis. These factors include those who run long distances, those with greater BMI, especially in the non-athletic population, an occupation that requires long periods of standing, pes cavus or pes planus, decreased dorsiflexion range of motion, leg length discrepancy, and hamstring tightness. Examination. The American Physical Therapy Association recently revised this clinical practice guideline for plantar fasciitis last year. Here we have a list of tests and measures that are important to investigate if you suspect a patient has chronic heel pain. Posture, gait, ankle passive range of motion, and active range of motion, particularly talocrural dorsiflexion, longitudinal arch angle, first MTP extension, the Windlass test, palpation of foot structures, outcome measures, and dorsiflexion eversion test. Clinical findings. Clinically, we will find reduced talocrural dorsiflexion, a positive Windlass test, a positive dorsiflexion eversion test, pes cavus or pes planus foot posture, gait deviations, weak dorsiflexors, especially in non-athletic populations, decreased MTP extension, or possible hip weakness.
Some of the postural and gait abnormalities that also present with this condition will be abnormal arch height and a pronated foot. Following an activity, such as first thing in the morning or after sitting for a while, patients will report having a painful first step or an antalgic gait with the initial steps after that inactivity. These symptoms and these signs are also consistent with limited hamstring extensibility and leg length discrepancy.
Interventions. According to the aforementioned clinical practice guideline, manual therapy, stretching of the triceps surae, taping, foot orthoses, and night splints are interventions that have the highest evidence. Taping is a cost-effective way to decide if a patient will benefit from orthoses, which are a more long-term and expensive way to support the arch of the foot. Stretching of both the gastrocnemius and plantar fascia itself is a great first intervention to give the patient on the first day of PT to do in clinic and at home for relief of symptoms. On the bottom row and to the very left is a picture of a night splint. The patient wears this device at night in order to provide a long duration, low load stretch to the gastroc while they sleep. Next to that picture is an example of a foot mobilization that could be effective. Shown is a medial guide of the subtalar joint, but there are numerous mobilizations that could be used. It is best practice to use any hypomobility findings from the clinical exam to drive which mobilizations that you choose. The following are interventions that have moderate evidence: iontophoresis, phonophoresis, low or low-level laser, a rocker bottom shoe, therapeutic exercise, neuromuscular reeducation and gait training, dry needling, and trigger point therapy. These interventions should be used based on patient presentation and if other treatments that have not had a positive response during early treatment. Dry needling, of course, depends on the state that you practice in and if you are qualified to provide such treatment. Ultrasound is not a recommended intervention. There is no quantified evidence on hip strengthening or gait training, but it's something to consider, especially if your patient presents with deficits in this area. Here's a summary of the interventions, along with a suggestion for which ones to prioritize in the management of plantar fasciitis.
As far as differential diagnosis, we have to keep an open mind about our patient's presentation, especially when the patient's impairments are not resolving with the specifically aimed interventions and treatment plan that you have created. If you have any doubt about this diagnosis, plantar fasciitis, you could use imaging, as we mentioned earlier, as it can be used to rule out other heel problems, such as heel fat pad atrophy, spondyloarthropathy, and plantar fibroma. The prognosis for this diagnosis is fairly good. Patients of this condition may present with chronic problems, though. The American family physicians say that most patients with plantar fasciitis eventually improve. In a long-term follow-up study, they found that 80% of patients treated conservatively for plantar fasciitis have complete resolution of pain after 4 years. Generally, patients that maintain a healthy weight, elect supportive shoes, and don't wear out worn-out athletic shoes, and also if they adhere to their stretching protocol and exercise plan, have an excellent prognosis. This creates better outcomes. Some of the outcome measures that you can use in clinic are self-report questionnaires, activity limitation measures, and physical impairment measures. The physical impairment measures are things that we can measure in clinic as PTs. For example, dorsiflexion range of motion and dorsiflexion eversion test. Some of the activity limitation measures you can use because they are easily reproducible and they can be performance-based measures. They assess the patient's level of function. These limitations can also be related to the patient's physical restrictions or participation restrictions. Some of the self-report questionnaires are the FFI, FHSQ, FAAM, and LEFS. These are different options that you can use depending on your patient presentation and what is most appropriate for them. Here's an example of the foot health status questionnaire, and you can see that it allows a patient to rank their progress. We hope that this information has been helpful for you. And always remember to refer back to the clinical practice guidelines for heel pain or plantar fasciitis in the APTA. Has been revised in 2014. Here are some resources. Thank you very much.